Tomo Thompson and Bill Taylor were two of the first employees of Reliant when the company was established in 1935. They are seen here with some of the models from those early days, and also with the Rally three-wheeler that they helped to build at Nottingham before Reliant was born. The founder of the company, Mr. T.L. Williams, who died in 1964, set up the original Reliant business in the workshop of his garden in Kettlebrook Road, Tamworth. And it was from these modest beginnings that the now internationally known company has grown. Particular major expansion scheme completed in 1960, 1963, and 1966. As the sites at Two Gates, Tamworth, and Shenston and Kettlebrook were enlarged or acquired for development purposes.
So in 1971, the directors of the company decided that it was time for a reappraisement of Reliant's potential. It was thought that with a new range of models and with modernized and enlarged production facilities, the company could double its size in the next 3 to 4 years. And so development work, which had been going on a new range of small cars, including a new three-wheel car, was accelerated. Plans were made for the engine plant at Shenston to have its capacity increased and its plant modernized. Our body plant at Kettlebrook likewise needed to be updated, the procedures to be changed, and the capacity increased. And at the Two Gates plant, where vehicles were assembled, we needed modernized and enlarged painting facilities and a new mechanical assembly shop. Plans for all these factors were drawn together, and a total bill was seen to be in prospect of some £1.75 million. By late 1971, plans were complete, board approval had been obtained, and work began. On this south side at Two Gates, Ron, I think we've got a new problem now. If we can't move this service department as we planned, then we've got to find some other space for our soft trim stores and for our seat department. Now then, I'd like that to be somewhere near Building 2. Where could that go?
Well, only one possibility, I would think, maybe extending Building 2 in this direction.
Well, if you do that, what you're going to have a problem on is area being very restricted. You cannot cut into that bank with extreme expenditure because of a rock outbreak. So that's likely to be expensive.
There is one other possibility, and that is maybe putting a second floor within Building 2.
We've got already provision in the foundations for a second floor.
Oh, well, let's have a look at that then. Well, that's Building 2 plan, Ron. Would you be happy with the seat department being located on a mezzanine floor in there?
I would say so. I think it'd be satisfactory.
And how much sort of space we'd want there, Bob?
Between 8 and 10,000 square feet, and we've got provision for putting a mezzanine right through that length, which is 15,000 square feet.
Thank you.
whole hillside had to be moved to provide the flat site required and to ensure the new factory would blend unobtrusively into the landscape. In 4 weeks, giant bulldozers and scrapers moved over 100,000 tons of earth, rock, and clay. The steel frames of the buildings were quickly erected, and the new factory began to take shape. Several new concepts in the production of glass fiber bodied cars were incorporated into these new workshops. Meanwhile, 2 miles away at Kettlebrook, old buildings were being stripped and modernized, and new workshops were under construction to supply the bodies of the new models in increased volumes to the Two Gates assembly plant. A new access road and gatehouse had to be constructed at Shenstone to provide the approach to the newly built parts warehouse and dispatch center. This large depot was necessary to support the ever-growing replacement parts business and to give a better service to dealers and customers. With the construction program well on the way, work on molds, jigs, and fixtures for the new models was proceeding at full speed. Thank you. Here we see the welding of one of the early chassis frames for a pre-production Robin saloon. The next stage in our story is the changeover from one-off prototype development to volume production. At Kettlebrook, one of the first production stages is the tailoring of the glass reinforcement mat to the precise sizes needed for the moulding process. 60 layers at a time are cut to predetermined shapes. The first coat of resin on the mould is applied by the spray process. This layer will provide the outside surface to the finished moulding when it is extracted from the mould, and will form the smooth surface necessary as a base for the spray painting of the car. All the bodies are hand moulded, and the required thickness and strength of moulding is built up from the tailored pieces of mat that we saw earlier. Here they are being placed in position and impregnated with a specially prepared resin. When the moulding process is complete, the resin is hardened in a purpose-built curing oven, and then the sections of the mould are parted from the newly made moulding. The surplus laminate is then trimmed off by high-speed routers, which work with jigs as guides, which themselves are made within the company from glass fibre. At Reliant, almost all mouldings except the bodies are produced on presses, some of them as large as 1,000 tons. The company has developed a special technique in producing lightweight pressed panels with a first-class surface finish, both of which characteristics are necessary for panels such as this three-wheeler van rear door. Reliant has a very wide spectrum of expertise covering almost every aspect involved in the manufacture of a motor car. Here we see some of the processes at the Shenstone factory, where engines, gearboxes, axles and suspension parts are made. Lightweight engine unit is hand-built from Shenstone-made components and is made up to a similarly produced gearbox before being forwarded to the Two Gates assembly plant, where it will be incorporated into another of Reliant's products. The frame pressings come from Reliant's sister company, Press Operations Limited of Tamworth, and are welded together on this modern welding track. They are then attached to an overhead conveyor and are double dipped to give long life protection against corrosion. Bodies are brought to the Two Gates assembly plant by transporter from the Kettlebrook body factory and then enter the flatting shop as a first stage of the painting process. Each body has two further rubbing down and flatting operations before the final color coat is applied. A range of 8 standard colors is immediately available from this new paint mixing and storage plant. After the final coat is applied, the body is subjected to a low bake temperature of 170 degrees Fahrenheit for 40 minutes, and then is ready for the final assembly operation. Axle and rear suspension components are built as sub-assemblies, and like the engine and gearbox, are installed from beneath the high-level assembly track. All trim items are now fitted, and the new robins roll off the assembly lines at the rate of 1 every 6.5 minutes. Every vehicle is double-checked, and final rectification is carried out where necessary before the vehicle is passed off for weight certification and road test. Thank you.
So by the end of 1973, the plans that had been so carefully and painstakingly drawn up 2 years before were complete. Production of the new Robin three-wheeler was underway at new record levels. New plant, the most advanced in Europe for the production of volume quantities of glass fiber vehicles, was in operation. The future held much prospects. And no doubt in due course, a repeat of this big operation that increased Reliant's capacity by over 50% would once again be drawn up and executed.
And so every Robin in due course finds its way into a Reliant dealership, seeking its proud owner to be from one of the four corners of Britain, or, as is happening to an increasing extent, from the ever-widening horizons of markets in Europe and even further afield. It's a far cry from those early days in the garden shed at Kettlebrook, but only one further stage in the constant growth of this remarkably versatile specialist manufacturer from Tamworth in the industrial heart of Britain.